Good morning, students. In the furtherance of the previous lecture, we are going to continue module 4, and today we are going to discuss 5 topics of module 4 encumbered into module 4. Now, the first topic being interpretation of amending statutes. Now, what is amendment? Amendment means a slight correction or an alteration, either by subtracting or adding a particular word or a particular phrase in a previously existing statute or a provision. Now, if you read, an amendment is a legislative act. Only the judiciary or the legislature are authorized and given the power to amend any act or any statute. And a legislative act to make changes or additions or subtractions in a previously existing statute or a law. Now, amendment acts or amended provisions or amended acts should be read as if the particular amendment had been written in the original act itself. While interpreting, while considering the particular amendment, you should not be considering it as something new. You should try and understand, one person should try and understand the scope behind why such amendment was done, the scope behind why the basic or the whole law had come into existence at the first place. Now, one case law which is given in your book is Vejravelu versus Special Deputy Director. Under this case, the word compensation under Article 31(2) of the Indian Constitution Act was of a question. Now, compensation, basically, what does compensation mean? If we talk under literal or layman language, compensation means अगर आपने कोई गलती करी है तो आप सामने वाले के बंदे का जो loss हुआ है उसके लिए आप उसको पे करोगे. You will be paying for the loss rendered by your mistake to the person who is the victim or who has got injured from your act or whatever you've done. Now, under this case, compensation was interpreted as the payment or any requirement which was supposed to be done by supposedly party A should be done before the strict acquisition or acquirement of the property. Now, similar was the case in similarly, in a different case altogether, State of West Bengal versus Bella Banerjee, the word under Article 31, compensation word was again used. Now, Justice Subba Rao had interpreted and taken the same meaning of the word which was interpreted under this particular case. Now, this means any, even when we are reading a bare act or wherever we are reading any law or statute, it is always written on the very first page that any act amending to codify this particular thing, which gives you basically a crux of what this act particularly does. Now, under the second case, State of West Bengal versus Bella Banerjee, compensation was again interpreted in the same way as was interpreted under Vejravelu versus State Special Deputy Director. Now, under amending statutes, it is not necessary that any previous statutes who've been amended cannot be taken into consideration. Yes, obviously it is very important that the amended statute, for example, A statute was amended to become A2. Now, statute A will not have a retrospective effect, and I'm sorry, act A2 will not have a retrospective effect. That means any acts who any cases or any decisions which were made under taking consideration of Act A will not be reversed or will not be changed if there is a change in the amendment in the new act which has come in force. Now, coming to the second topic for today is consolidating statutes. Now, what is consolidating statute? Consolidate. If we try and divide this term into two. Now, consolidating statutes. Consolidating statutes are statutes which combine and collect all the statutory provisions related to a particular subject matter. At one place, on one particular topic, one subject matter, and it is easy for a person to interpret and get to a reasonable decision. Now, I can, one very good example of this such particular statute is Arbitration Act. Now, if you are not aware of Arbitration Act, is Arbitration Act basically provides you with all the resolutions and the procedure of how a person who is, if a particular case is falling under out of court settlement, whereby we are going to discuss it in probably another subject, which is alternative dispute resolution. You have three dispute methods whereby you can settle your case outside of the court. There is no need of going for a proper legal proceeding. So any query, any penalty, any requirement of how the process is supposed to be done is supposed to be found in this particular act. So this basically becomes a cumulative or a consolidated form of set of form of rules and provisions regarding to ADR, which is alternative dispute resolutions. Now, coming to a case law, one case law which also provides, now this, the decision and the holding of this particular case is also the objective of why consolidating acts are important. Now, Bestwick, under the case Bestwick versus Bestwick, now it, the main objective, now if we discuss what is the main objective of statutory acts, consolidated acts, Now, what is the objective? To collect the statutory law and bringing upon a particular subject and bring it to use. Now, bringing a particular law which is on a particular topic and consolidating them and making them coming into use by normal people and people who are not aware of what exactly and how are things to be dealt with. This is basically what was the objective behind why consolidating acts were named and came into existence at the first place. Now, what kind of a reason, what kind of an interpretation are consolidating statutes go through? Now, they undergo an interpretation which is reasonable interpretation. Now, reasonable interpretation means any statute which is a consolidated form of a particular subject matter or a particular law should be interpreted reasonably, as to which means you should try and interpret it in such a manner that it is for the greatest benefit of a greatest for a greater amount of people. It gives and it sets an example in front of the society and is for the betterment of the society at par. You should also try and see at what intensity the crime was committed and what exactly are the foresights and the future foresights of the decision which one person is going to make under a consolidating statute. Now, coming to the third topic for today, we are going to study codified statutes. Codified statutes are we've all read that we have one uniform law, we have one codified system, law should be codified, there should be a proper symmetry as to why why it is the way it is in India. Now, basically we do follow a codified system of law in India, and very well example of it being is, like, for example, in Indian Penal Code. Indian Penal Code is one of the very good examples of codified statutes which we've been reading for a quite long time now. Now, codified statutes are basically statutes which purport state exhaustively. They impose certain laws on the states on a particular subject matter. So, along with examples and a systemized manner of case laws. That is probably one of the main differences between these two statutes, which being consolidated and codified statutes. Consolidating statutes might give you illustrations, might give you examples related to what exactly, how, and different types of examples and illustrations regarding to what one situation, how one situation can lead up to four other exceptions and four other examples. But under codified statute, we are provided with a systemized manner of landmark case laws, where we are able to recall and recollect and understand as to what and how that particular decision and this particular case or the particular provision was interpreted by the judge himself. And we are also lucky enough to understand at how the resolutions and people were benefited or not benefited in some cases by certain laws and case laws. Now, codified statutes in one sentence can be said a consolidated act plus a common law on a particular matter which has been followed by previous years. Now, I've already written that it includes case laws, which is the prime difference between a consolidating statute and a codified statute. Now, under this case, I'm going to give you an example of case Subba Rao versus State of Maharashtra, under which Income Tax Act was interpreted, and it was clearly retained from the act itself that this act gives you the amended and the codified statute, codified manner as to how taxes are to be paid and so on and so forth. So Income Tax Act is not to be interpreted in any manner. It gives you a particular and a compact form as to how taxes are supposed to be paid by people. Now, coming to the fourth and the fifth, which are the last topics for today's module, are Mandatory and Directory Acts. Now, mandatory. The layman meaning of mandatory is you are compulsified, you are obligated to do a particular act. If you are resulting to, there are two segregations. If you do an act, you are penalized. You are given a punishment or you are given a monetary punishment. If you do the act, you are not doing anything void or you are not doing anything illegal under the eyes of law. Whereby directory acts, it is self-explanatory that directory acts direct you to perform a certain act, but you are not bound to. They give you a particular procedure, they give you a step-by-step direction as to how a particular act should be done. This directory acts may and might not end up leading a person to be get punished until and unless they are contrary to how they should be done and under the procedure of a codified law or a particular rule. Now, how are you going to describe? Now, for example, I would like to clarify there are directory and mandatory statutes as well as there are directory and mandatory provisions. Now, how are you going to segregate? Now, for example, IPC is a mandatory and a directory statute. It provides you with certain rules which are to be followed with utmost strictness, and it also gives you a direction as to how certain procedures to be done. Now, the very first example that comes to my mind related to directory statutes is CPC. That is Civil Procedure Code, which provides you as to how an appeal should be made. It provides you as to how a witness should be summoned. It provides you various case scenarios. It provides you with various acts to be done so that a particular person can. It makes easier for a person as to how an appeal should be done. We are educated people. It is very easy for us. But if this codified statute did not exist, people who are not aware of the laws or people who are not aware of their own rights might never understand the intensity of the procedures and the appeals and where to go and how to do it. So that is what the main importance of a directory act means and a provision means. Now, there are certain words which should strike you when it comes to mandatory and directory acts. Now, when we talk about mandatory acts, the two words that might strike you are shall and must. These two words give you, or even when you listen. Now, for example, if I say, you shall do a particular essay, you shall write a particular essay of 5,000 words and submit it to me by tomorrow. Now, the word shall gives you a sense of command, which makes it obligatory on you to submit that essay to me. Similarly, when we come on talking to law base and legal terms, any term or any provision where shall and must, which usually both the terms are used together, and they might be also used with the combination of a word may, which is a directory term. We'll come to that later. But shall and must give you a sense of command, which basically mean that you are ought to. You have no choice. You are not given a second option of disobeying or obeying this particular fact. It is not under your conscience, and it is not up to your regarding that you want to do it or you don't want to do it. It is mandatory. It is you are obligated to do a particular act. Likewise, we come to the word directory acts, directory provisions. Now, the word which is used for directory provisions are may. May gives you a sense of exception. May gives you a sense of slight doubtfulness. It also provides you with a slight option. You know, it provides you with a certain option. It gives you a window whereby you are not obligated, but yes, you are also not fully relaxed to do a particular act. Now, for example, a student asking a teacher, ma'am, may I please drink water? So he is seeking a permission. You are seeking a permission. So it depends on the particular teacher. For example, it depends on me whether I want to give him permission or whether I not. It is totally in my hands. But nobody can deny, nobody can punish me for not giving him the permission. Now, similarly, you are not obligated, you are not forced. No one can force you to do any directory act until and unless you do it with your full consent and when you are like in sound mind and other stuff. Now, for example, any particular person. Now, for example, if there are like certain examples, like for example, if you start reading IPC, you are going to find these words shall and may written under many provisions. Like for example, if I'm recollecting, there is this provision regarding to false documents in the Indian Evidence Act. So there are certain provisions, certain acts where you are going to be be confused among these two provisions. But you are also you should also remember that any act which is directory is not forced upon you until and unless you follow altogether a different procedure on as to how this particular act was done, and until and unless this particular act which was directed to you is void and illegal. Now, this is all for today's lecture. We are going to continue with module 5 in the next lecture. Thank you so much.